our new film called Lost in the Fine Print that's about banning forced arbitration. Be on the lookout for information about screening coming soon near you. And I can talk a little bit more about that because I think it also impacts women's rights directly. Forced arbitration is one of those issues that basically impede every aspect of enforcement of our civil rights laws in this country, including the laws that are meant to protect women's rights. And then our Voter Advocacy Society, we advise nonprofits on the rules for engaging in lobbying and policy work and how they can do that and maintain their tax status as exempt organizations and the IRS's rules and their state and local lobbying rules. So we kind of cover the spectrum. We don't work on specific issues, but we work across issues. And so in terms of the Supreme Court last term, I would say that there were three big cases that really affected women's rights. Hobby Lobby being, I think, the one that probably most of you have heard about, but there are also two others, McCullough versus Coakley, which dealt with a buffer zone around abortion clinics. Lukey, I'm sure, can talk more about that case. And where the justices struck down the buffer zone, saying that, that the 35-foot zone was too far, and basically saying that an 8-foot moving zone around the woman as she's trying to enter the clinic is probably good enough, because the people trying to counsel her were just doing it in a really kind, nice way, not being vicious at all, in the face of lots of evidence to the contrary. And then there was Harris versus Quinn, and that might be a case that you might not necessarily think of as affecting women's rights, but it really does, because the vast majority, it was a case that dealt with the labor rights of state workers to unionize, and whether workers who are in-home service workers who are partially paid for by the state, and that's sometimes considered state workers, have the ability to join unions, or whether they would be forced to, in the words of the woman who brought the case. And the Supreme Court there basically said that workers can't be forced to pay dues, even if they, which is sort of the rule right now, whether you are in a union or not in a union, if there's a union in your workplace, you pay dues because the union impacts the work that you do, right? And so in this context, the Supreme Court said, well, these are just quasi-state employees, and so we're not going to force them to do that. And that means that millions of women who work as in-home healthcare workers across the country now will not have the benefits of unions, unless they specifically opt in, and that's a really hard thing to do for a lot of women, for a lot of people in general. So that was a really closely watched case for the bigger implications on union and labor rights in this country, but I think it has those threads for women because women make up the majority of in-home care workers, so it had a huge impact on their abilities. And I think there's a corollary here in California. You all may have heard that there was a law, AB 1522, that Governor Brown just signed into law that expands and requires employers to provide 3 paid sick days to workers, regardless of the number of employees that that a company has. Well, at the last minute, and unfortunately at Governor Brown's urging, one of the things that happened was that in-home care workers were specifically excluded from being required to be provided paid sick days. And that was, I think, a big blow. There was a big split in not only the labor community, but the progressive community about whether, you know, getting 3 sick days for the vast majority of people was enough. And even though we were leaving behind this important segment who gets the shaft, frankly, in a lot of ways, and only won what commonly known as the Domestic Workers Bill of Rights last year that Governor Brown signed after, I think, the third try. Getting them to sign in. So there's a lot of stuff that's happening at both at the Supreme Court and at the state level here in California that impact our rights as women and as workers. And I think it's really important to keep in mind those intersectional relationships because when you can collaborate with sort of unusual suspects, it really brings people together. So I'll give you another example of an area that Emily's familiar with from some work she did this summer for us, and that one of my colleagues and I at Meta has been doing a lot of work with the Women's Policy Institute and the Women's Foundation of California on, And that's this rule called the maximum family grant rule, where basically, if you're on welfare in California and you have kids, there's a certain amount of money that you're entitled to, okay, under the rules. If you decide to have another kid, you get no more money for that kid. That's the rule. So a child who's born into poverty in California, whose parents are already in poverty, gets no support from the state for having been born in that situation, and it just perpetuates the cycle. And it impacts reproductive justice issues, right? How many women in poverty can have kids and will have more kids and be able to choose their way that they want to plan their family, even though they're in poverty and that shouldn't be an impingement on them. Those are choices that they should be able to make. It's a poverty issue, obviously, so there are poverty groups that are interested in that, anti-poverty groups. It's a medical issue. So there's just a wide variety of groups that can come together and talk about that. So in the last 2 years, there have been bills in the California legislature to repeal this maximum family grant rule. And it got fairly far this year, but was killed in the Appropriations Committee. They'll try again. There's ideas about getting it through the budget process and other inside baseball stuff that I won't bore you with. But the idea there is that, you know, what looks like a simple issue actually sort of touches on all of these other areas. So those are sort of the big picture things that I just wanted to mention. I'm happy to talk about any more sort of specifics about what's happening in California. There are a lot of other, you know, reproductive justice bills. I'd say here in California, just to shift to the second question that Emily asked me to talk about, which is the rights of pregnant workers. As a pregnant worker currently myself, I am very attuned to this, and I also have a 2-year-old son, so I've been through the process here in California, and have been amazed at the number of friends of mine that I've had to help through the process, and that even as a lawyer who's been doing employment law for over a decade, working directly on these issues, it is a complex web of rules and laws that you have to navigate to understand sort of what your rights are in the workplace as a regular worker, but also specifically as a pregnant worker. So pregnancy discrimination is real. It's really prevalent. I like to think of it as, in a lot of ways, there's different categories. So one of my favorite topics is implicit bias. And one of my favorite categories of implicit bias is what I like to call benevolent bias, which is where you look at someone and you are thinking that you're being helpful, right? By telling them that you're doing this for their own good. But in reality, what you're doing is discriminating against them and telling them that they can't do something that they should be entitled to do. So, for instance, there was a woman in Texas who worked at a store, and she wanted to apply to be a manager, and her boss told her, well, you have a family, so I wouldn't want to impact your being able to spend time with your family, because this job is going to require a lot of travel. Well, that, I think, is a prime example of benevolent discrimination, right? Where someone's really trying to... So, pregnancy discrimination, I think, often falls in that category. It can often be, you know, much more overt and not benevolent, but that's certainly something that we see. And one of the biggest areas for pregnant women is the lack of accommodations that are provided to them while they're working in the workplace. So you're working as a cashier at Walmart, and you aren't allowed to sit, you know, or have a bottle of water at your desk. Or anything like that. So there have been, for a long time, there's been a law called the Pregnancy Discrimination Act, which was designed to address some of these concerns, but it does not include a reasonable accommodation provision. There have been a lot of employment lawyers across the country who have won successfully cases alleging that pregnancy discrimination is really sex discrimination. And that, I think, is, you know, a very valid way of looking at it, right? But for the fact that you're a woman, you won't get pregnant, and thus, you know, wouldn't be discriminated against in this context. the EEOC, the U.S. Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, recently updated their 30-year-old guidelines on pregnancy discrimination. So the first time in 30 years that they've actually gone back and updated these things. But they really, I think, they did a fabulous job of doing it. They really, I think, enshrined a lot of things in the law that we know that we would logically think should be the way things are, but that employers often get wrong, in my opinion. So that just happened this year, and that was a big step forward because it included things like, because the Americans with Disabilities Act was amended a few years ago, it's likely, like here in California, it's already considered, pregnancy is sometimes considered a temporary disability, depending on what you're experiencing, how you're experiencing the pregnancy. I'm very fortunate it hasn't been a difficult one, but you know, a lot of women have debilitating motions, like morning sickness, like her Bucky Middleton and her, you know, hospital stays because of morning sickness. And I have friends who've been there. And that's part of what, you know, sometimes can be disabling enough to be qualified under law as a temporary disability. So here in California, once you hit 36 weeks of pregnancy, you are eligible for disability insurance. And can go on that until 6 to 8 weeks after the birth of your child, depending on whether it was a natural birth or a C-section. And that combined with a number of other things made California's laws very advanced in across the country in how they deal with pregnant workers and their ability to take care of their children, bond with their children, not only women but also men. I think that it's important to remember that what happens to the father affects the mother as much as it affects the child. And so it should be a holistic system that addresses everyone. So there is a pending in Congress, and we know that this Congress has not done a whole lot. and so we don't, unfortunately, expect this to move very far, but there is a Pregnant Workers Fairness Act that would enshrine some of these accommodation considerations into law, because it is a struggle. Every time you have to deal with it, you have to make these, you know, long claims, complicated claims, when it should be much more straightforward, and that's what that's designed to do. Because Congress hasn't been moving, a number of states have moved in its stead, so New York City, Philadelphia, the state of Delaware, the state of West Virginia, California already had them, and a number of other places have passed versions of the Pregnant Workers Fairness Act to allow for accommodations for pregnant women in the workplace, and that's all happened in the last 18 months. So that's been a big shift and movement that we've seen, along with the paid sick days movement. You know, minimum wage is one of those issues that is a women's rights issue because the vast majority of women the vast majority of low-wage workers are women of color and women, and the vast majority of tipped workers who only make $2.15 an hour for their tips are women and women of color. And so those are big issues that are playing out around the country. There will be, obviously, ballot measures in Oakland on the minimum wage, down in San Diego, up in Richmond. We expect those to be playing out this fall in Los Angeles. So here in California, even though we have a higher minimum wage than usual, Oakland is trying to move its minimum wage to $15 an hour, which would be the highest in the country. And that ballot measure is polling at something like 70% right now, so we're pretty optimistic that it's going to get passed, but that doesn't mean that people should stop caring about it or working for it or encouraging their friends in other places to be voting on it. So that's, I think, kind of a big, broad overview of a lot of things, and I'm happy to answer any questions you have about how I got here or any of the specific topics when it's time. So,
thanks. Thank you so much, Rebecca. So, next is Lupe. Ryan, do you want to introduce?
Chair for Alaska Law Students Association, and we sponsor this event, and we did some help in finding speakers, and our speaker, or the speaker associated with our organization, is Lupe Rodriguez. I have a short bio for her, if you want to read. very short because there's a lot. She served on the board of directors of California Family Health Council, and now she has the board of access to women's health justice. And she also sits on the board of California Latinas for Reproductive Justice. She serves as the chair of the Santa Clara County Commission on the Status of Women and is an advisor for the Women's Health and Rights Program at the Center for American Progress in Washington, D.C. And she has a BA in neurobiology from Harvard University.
Thank you for having me, everybody. And Q, I was like, I'm not going to make it. This is really wacky. Not expected. But so, you know, thanks again for having me. I'm here to talk about the perspective, you know, the reproductive justice perspective and how the intersection also between that and immigrant rights. And I am, you know, just as by way of background of, you know, where I come from, I think a little bit was mentioned in the bio. I work now at Planned Parenthood Marmonte, which is the largest Planned Parenthood in the country, and we're based in San Jose and have, you know, health centers throughout the state of California, Nevada. And my work there is in community outreach and government relations and communications and all kinds of things, actually. My job is kind of like an amalgam of different things altogether. And I, you know, at the organization, though, I'm also working to expand the kind of reach of Planned Parenthood as not only a health organization. I mean, I think that that's the core of the organization. We're always going to be a health organization, but we, and a health care organization specifically, but we also are very concerned about the issues that affect our patients and that affect, frankly, their quality of life, their health outcomes, and things that, you know, we can't necessarily control inside the health center, but that we can do lots of things about outside of the health center, in advocacy, in education and outreach, in partnering and being good allies with organizations that are doing work that's supportive of our patients. And, you know, I come into this organization and in this role from a very interesting background. I worked at Access Women's Health Justice, which is a small organization based in Oakland. That's actually the largest abortion fund in the country and provides very practical help and support for women in the state of California and outside of California sometimes, who you know, despite our really great laws, I think, you know, she mentioned that we have really great laws in California that protect, you know, reproductive health and rights in a lot of ways. We've actually, you know, passed some laws in the last couple of years and we've expanded access to abortion care and birth control and other things. But we still find, and through Access, we still find that women don't have access to care. Even though, you know, the laws are all there, the practical sort of existence that they experience keeps a lot of women from being able to access the care they need. And so Access has worked throughout the years to connect women with very practical care and support to the services that they need. So, you know, connecting them to health insurance. A lot of women, you know, now that the ACA has sort of been implemented, a lot more people have coverage. But before, you know, there were a lot of women who were uninsured, and nobody really knows that in the state of California, if you're pregnant, you can access the Medi-Cal for Pregnancy program. So, you know, Access came in to connect people to that program in the first place, and then from there they could get access to services. So that was one big barrier. And then there are other barriers like, well, the health center that is near my house in rural Fresno, you know, won't see me for 3 weeks. And at that point, I'm too far along in my pregnancy for my termination that I want. So I have to travel to San Francisco. Oh, and I don't have a car. I don't have money for bus fare. I don't have childcare. So there are all these sort of practical things that keep people from getting the healthcare they need, particularly reproductive healthcare that you know, we seek to kind of find, identify, and help overcome. And so, you know, coming from that background and coming from that sort of perspective of, like, there's still so many issues in terms of access, particularly for, you know, low-income women, women who are isolated, women who live in rural areas, you know, women of color. I'm bringing that perspective to Planned Parenthood, and that's why I'm really interested in talking about what we're doing in terms of immigration rights, and also the perspective is sort of brought us here. I think, you know, again, we see the majority of the patients that we see at our health centers are people of color. In fact, I think 47% of the people that we work with in our health centers are Latinos. And of that, about, I think another 20% are undocumented immigrants. And we know that, you know, a challenge has always been, particularly with the ACA implementation, which is completely left out undocumented immigrant communities from being able to access paid coverage. You know, we're sort of trying to fill those gaps. And we see a lot of times that people still sort of face those the fear of seeking healthcare because of the fear of the repercussions of, you know, with immigration status and what that might, you know, cause them. We see that people, you know, come into the health center not understanding that they have access to services, and you know, that it's their right to seek healthcare regardless of their immigration status. And we also see that a lot of people with like mixed status families coming into the health centers, you know, particularly when we were doing, and because we were doing health reform enrollment processes at our health centers, we saw that a lot. We saw people sort of coming in and wanting to enroll parts of their family, but not being able to enroll other parts of their family. And so we really sort of, it really created an awareness for us about the need to support programs in the community that connect, you know, these folks who are facing this very sort of like pressing issue of you know, the fear of not having documented status, and you know, making the connection for them to be able to seek services, you know, completely and without fear and without any kind of delay. And so we've started doing is actually we have a partnership right now only in San Jose with an organization called Siren that does services integration resources. Network and they're based in San Jose, and they do work to connect people in the community to services, so particularly immigrants and undocumented immigrants. And we've been doing some work with them to, you know, to increase understanding of the community about their rights, about the, particularly when it comes to healthcare. And we've been also actually stepping out of our bounds. And again, this is something that people find unusual for, you know, long-standing reproductive rights, reproductive health organization. That we're actually working with them to advocate in the community for its comprehensive immigration reform. You know, actually, we've signed on to a statement of support for immigration reform in the United States. We're actively sort of campaigning with folks in the community around these issues, and I think, you know, it really sort of ties in again with our mission, with this idea of reproductive justice. I think. It was mentioned that the idea of reproductive justice is that people should be able to make decisions about their lives in a very sort of holistic manner. But the choice to, you know, the reproductive choice and reproductive justice isn't just about, you know, whether or not we have the right to have an abortion, whether or not we have the right to birth control. It's really about, you know, having the right to parent the families, or to have the families that we want, to parent our children the way that we want, to not live in fear of being separated by deportation or by other sort of like, you know, punitive things that happen with our immigration system, to be able to, you know, provide the best opportunities for our children. So all of that stuff really ties into this idea of reproductive justice. And as an organization that's a supportive ally of reproductive justice organizations, we're trying to sort of step in that direction. I think one other thing that I want to say about this issue is that one of the things that we've noticed is that a lot of folks come into this work with this idea that, particularly from organizations that are, you know, like, that are reproductive rights organizations that are sort of like, you know, helping control population and that kind of thing. They come into this work with this idea that oh, you know, we want to get involved in this issue because we would like to control the population of people that are, you know, that are having babies in this country, or, you know, we want to ensure that people who don't have the means don't reproduce, and you know, this really sort of like horrific mentality really about the approach to this work. And again, I think the bottom line for us, and I think for all of us to know, is that this work is done because we believe that, you know, health outcomes a person's ability to live the full life that they want and real reproductive choice comes from having the resources, the support, the power, the political power to be able to make the best choices for yourselves and your families and to really have an effect on the choices you make. So you don't make choices because you are afraid of the consequences of your immigration status. You don't make choices know, based on fear, based on social pressures that you shouldn't have. So so that's I think my time's up. So I'll say about that. If you have any questions.
Thank you.
Thanks so much, Lupe. All right, next we have Ms. Major and Jen.
My name is Danny. I'm here on behalf of TriBlock to introduce Ms. Janetta. Ms. Johnson is an Afro-American transsexual from Tampa, Florida. She recently survived 3 years in federal prison and is committed to developing strategies and interventions to reduce the recidivism rate in the transgender community. She served as an interim organizing director in November/December of 2008. And planned vibrant grassroots fundraisers and later put her skills as a community organizer, trainer, and activist to use inside as she fiercely and tirelessly advocated for her rights as a transgender person in jail and prison. Unfortunately, I don't have a bio on Ms. Major, but I'm sure she'll
tell you about it. Okay, so I'm Cynthia Chandler. I'm the director of public interest programs here, and Ms. Major is so Ms. Major was at Stonewall. Ms. Major was politicized in Attica. Ms. Major is probably the grand dame of the transgender women activist movement. She's been a major in the gay pride parade in this year in San Francisco. And Ms. Major really is just like a mentor to thousands of people working for trans liberation. So
it's an honor to have you. Like you said, my name is Janetta, and I've worked in the past in, as a case manager, substance abuse counselor, primary social services. However, I found myself in a situation where I ended up making a poor decision, doing 3.5 years in prison, and that's when I took the opportunity. I mean, as soon as I knew that I was going to be in prison, I just made the decision that I had to focus on recidivism and just really look at how I got there and how the rest of my community got there. So at that time, I began to really, really not only soul searching myself and look at some of the things that I felt like put me in a situation where I would make the decision to sell drugs. So, and the economy changed and I was scared. I was really, really afraid based on the fact that, you know, stuff was changing and people were losing, and then people were losing employment, housing, and all these things. And being a transgender person is just like, okay, I really panicked because we're always the last one to be taken care of. And so that's how I ended up being in prison. And when during the time that I served 3.5 years, I took the opportunity out to interview every transgender person that I could to kind of find out a little bit about our story and find out what got us there and just how, you know, a lot of the social pressures put us in situations where we feel like we have to immediately jump into survival mode just to get our needs met. And as you speak about the reproductive part, when I heard about that, I started to think and I said, no one ever talked to us as transgender people about the reproducing, especially MTF, transgender, male to female transgender. And I think about, you know, going to doctors and going, first starting my hormonal therapy and just, you know, the conversation never came up about, one day you might want to have kids. Is there any support that we could provide to you? Or even maybe, you know, explain the decision making and possibly starting hormones later. And so, yeah, and then we just, I'm going to let this make it up.
Hello, I'm Ben.
somebody really gives us a second thought, even though right now we happen to be the flavor of the month. If all these people now stepping up and just the forefront of getting stuff, this is a burning college and then a mock itself. And that's really a nice thing, but the thing to consider about all this is it didn't start here. We didn't just pop up this year and all of a sudden, there we are. The stuff and abuses that have been happening have been going on for years and years. People feel as if, well, you all are not in the Bible and you're an abomination to God. But that's nice. My parents thought I was an abomination to them. So there's no telling where that kind of thought comes from. The thing is that when they were talking and you all are on this thing about reproductive justice, there's a tendency to forget that reproductive justice isn't just about children. It's about reproducing who you are, how you think, what you pass on, what you leave for the next generation to have, to nurture and grow on, so that they can also do the things that need to be done. You know, it's a matter of realizing that everybody, not just my community, has issues of being transitioning into something else. None of us today are the way we were yesterday or the day before. So it isn't just my community. You know, none of us, you know, that I can think of anybody who has, as a teenager, felt as if, oh, well, everything's right, it's raining, I'm getting along fine in the world. Let me step out there and just do my thing. No one does that. Not you all and not us. You know? And just because we happen to want to take this to an extreme level from an opposite point of view about who we are, doesn't mean necessarily that we have lost our mind. We're not crazy people. We didn't sit one day and go, oh shit. You know what? It's Thursday. I need to be a woman today. You know, it gets down to the point of realizing that in doing the stuff that you do and with the work and the position that you all are headed toward, to take everybody's situations and who they are into consideration, not just the facts of whatever case they did or whatever they did, but to consider what put them there, how they got there in the first place. You know, no one starts off being bad, absolutely nobody. And until you get hungry, you don't think about stealing food. Until you can't pay rent, you don't think about stealing money. You know, so situations also are heavily induced by what we do or act on as people. And the thing to think about is, you know, and going through this stuff about reproductive justice, realize that there's a physical side to that, hormones, surgeries, treatments, doctors, you know, your hereditary thing that you adapt to, like glaucoma, high blood pressure, that needs to be considered. And on top of that, then there's a mental aspect of this. Not that everybody is a crazy person, but every now and then you need somebody to talk to in regards to how you got to where you are, what are the steps to take to get out of that position, and to have yourself in some place that you can give benefit to somebody else. This isn't just a mean world, you know. We are here with other people. We are here in regards to trying to make things better, not just for yourself, but for other people. Because if we don't get along together and we don't help one another, there's not going to be anything to help. There aren't going to be people you to take care of. And eventually the shit's going to hit the fan and everybody is not going to understand how to live with stuff, how to deal with stuff, or how to get along while that's happening. One of the fortunate things I feel about my community is after the dust settles, we're going to be the bitches to get up, dust this shit off, and keep going. But as long as this is helpful, this isn't new to us. We've learned how to adapt, how to change, how to make things work. And only through your help to get us in a position of being able to help somebody else learn this, that's what we need to kind of score. And to take into consideration not just how we got here, but how you all got to where you all are at. What is the reason that put you here? What thought got you decided this is what you want to do? For what person? For what political thing? You know, take everything into consideration and be a part of movements and things that are outside of what your realm of comfort is. We can always be comfortable. Things are not a bed of roses. They lied to me too. Oh, the golden years are going to be so wonderful. The golden years are not wonderful. I'm 73. Be on me. I have not seen the golden years. And our that's the only way it's going to grow. That's the only way things are going to get better. And as you move forward through that, that's what you want to do. You want to look behind you and realize, well, I did. So do.
Last but not least, my name is Michelle. I'm LSRJ co-president, and CLS has asked me to introduce Misty for them. Misty is the campaign and coordinations director at Justice Now, which is where I interned over the summer, and she was also one of my supervisors. Justice Now is a human rights and prison abolitionist organization. Misty's work focuses on policy, campaign, and communications to effect change within the community. So she'll be discussing SB 1135, which is an anti-sterilization bill, because women that are in our justice system are being mistreated. And so she is going to talk about that.
Justice Now is this insane organization that was founded by two completely insane idealistic leaders. One of them sits in this room. She still is training half the idealism. Older, more people, all of it, older, more important this way. And Justice Now works really collaboratively. First, I would like to say, in terms of reproductive justice, the fact that we work specifically in women's prisons puts us intrinsically at the intersection of reproductive justice. So with that, we also have a focus and a very direct mission and a very direct value to say of those people, voices of those that are inside, and letting them be the leaders of this movement, because they are the ones that are oppressed, they are the ones that are directly affected, and they are the ones that should have the voice to push for the change. We out here work to support them. So we do a lot of collaborative work in terms of communications, in terms of research, in terms of identifying problems. Through direct service, through that's how I got Justice Now. In 1999, I caught a case, filed a life sentence, and got it down to 12 years with two strikes. So I had plenty of time to sit there and think about prisons and what they are and how they affect people. And that Justice Now can cause me to think of it in a really different way, which is the prison will have you say what you did wrong and why everything is your fault. And whereas, instead of seeing the systems and how things play and how people end up in those places. So in that, we at Justice Now started looking at pregnancy care and postpartum care. And an interesting thing came up in that, while looking at that and while talking to people who are pregnant and who had children in prison, and finding out that tubal ligations were going on. Tubal ligations inside prisons are actually illegal and have been since 1979. So to find out that that was going on, you know, raised dollars with Justice Now and raised alarms, and we started doing a very specific look into tubal ligations and into sterilizations. More alarmingly, we found in sort of like the prison I was in did not house pregnant people. However, the prison I was in and all the prisons, there's also hysterectomies and oophorectomies, partial or complete, that happen inside that were also happening. So we started looking at all this and pulling all this together and found a very eugenicist theory practice that was going on, looking at the history of eugenics and looking at the practices that were going on and why people were, who was being targeted and why. So we look at how many. We know that through our own research, we know that over 100 people had tubal ligations. The state audit that was just completed earlier this year identified 144 illegal tubal ligations that took place. They don't claim they're all illegal, we do. They claim some of them, that a lot of them were done without proper consent, which we'll talk about informed consent in a little while. We have no idea. I mean, we have plenty of documentation of people who were given hysterectomies and oophorectomies. Who had no medical condition or reason why they shouldn't have them, but were told that they did have these medical conditions, only to later find out that they did not. We also came across people who had hysterectomies or oophorectomies and were not told that they had them, were told that they still had their reproductive parts. And it would take working with Justice Now and fighting to get medical records. we're still documenting, we're still getting letters. Recently we found one person who was being told she needed a hysterectomy and refused because they could not provide proof. They moved her down to CIW, Central California Institute for Women, which is in Southern California, where she did not want to be for the removal of her family, only to have the doctors down there tell her she had any cancer, she could not need a hysterectomy. So we're still documenting, still trying to find out how many, because we actually don't know. It's really hard. The CDCR hides behind privacy laws and doesn't want to disclose a lot. And then just people on parole, people get out. It's really hard to identify the numbers. So in the timeline that Justice now looked at was starting around 2006 through 2010 was the intense focus. And the reason we started looking at 2006 was around that time they had a presentation in Sacramento on the Gender Responsive Strategies Committee, who was talking about the cost efficacy of sterilizing women in prison and trying to talk about how to skirt around the law and how to skirt around the CCR policy that they could not perform to allegations because they were not medically necessary. So there was a presentation around how to skirt that and how to be able to offer tubal ligations to people inside women's prisons in order to save the welfare state money. So who gets targeted in this? People of color, obviously. People with low education who don't understand what the doctors are telling them. People who have too many kids. People who have long criminal records or who have long sentences are told, you're not going to have children anyway. So there's also a targeting that goes on in that. Also, I know when we did the audit, we wanted them to look back further. We argued for them to look back further and to look into what was going on. And we had an interesting experience with this bill in working with the Federal Receiver's Office, who oversees medical for the prisons. Because we don't usually get along with the receiver's office. And on this one, even Joyce Hayhoe, who does policy for the receiver's office, came back after the audit was ordered. Actually, she backed us up in having a broader scoped audit, but came back and said, I fully support this bill because she had looked back into files going back into the 90s and won't tell us what she saw, but she was pretty disgusted, so I'm very curious. My own experience in 1997, I was pregnant with my third son and I was in jail for a drug charge in the Central Valley, in a very rural part. And I was also in solitary confinement, which isn't the greatest place to be when you're pregnant. And didn't think I wanted more children. So when I went on one of my visits to the OBGYN, which happens when I'm in solitary confinement, so that means when I get taken out, I get leg shackled, I get belly shackled. You're in this wonderful uniform and you're paraded past people who are free and happy they're having children. And not that I wasn't happy I was having a child, but it's definitely a different experience. I went in there and I asked the doctor for a tubal ligation, which I knew from conversations with my mother when I was a teenager. And they handed me a paper and I signed it. Anybody in law school, if you go over what informed consent law is, that's okay. And let's say that for the camera, that's not it. Signed the paper, went back to the cell by myself and thought about it. Luckily, I paroled just before I had my son. Did not have a tubal ligation at that time, but I know what the experience is like to sign a paper into that. So then we get to coercion. So coercion came in the form of doctors telling people they would lose their parental rights, they would lose their access to welfare. Just the fact that a doctor has the same power over you as a correctional officer, that they can punish you, that they can sit there and say you're being uncooperative and write you up and take away the date that you would go home and cause you to stay longer. Just the fact that they're a doctor and they're supposed to know what they're telling you, and you're supposed to be able to believe that they're telling you the truth. To asking people under anesthesia to sign papers, asking people to sign papers after it was done, are all forms and ways that coercion happened. Even just my own experience, even though it wasn't over coercion, just the circumstances under which you're signing it is coercive. So we get all the way to SB 1135, which is today, which happened due to a media blitz. We pushed for years, as Justice Now. I happened to be with Cindy, Ms. Chandler, I don't know what you people call her. Cindy. In 2010 in Sacramento, we happened to be there. It was, I don't know if it was the first time, but it was the first time I had really heard the impact and the scope of this issue, and heard the air get sucked out of the room in Sacramento, and nobody knew how to react or what to say. Mostly because people in Sacramento sanctioned this, even though they won't admit it. 2006 was a serious spike in the number of tubal ligations, even though they said they wouldn't condone it, wouldn't allow it, yet the population didn't spike, nor were there any other identifiable reasons, other than this presentation of cost efficacy. So a media blitz came around last summer, and it propelled the legislature into motion. So we got SB 1135, which clarifies, it's a sunshine bill. It moves from the health code to the penal code that tubal ligations are in fact illegal in any institution where a person is involuntarily confined. And it also adds in safeguards around diagnoses. So now, hopefully, when women go to a doctor and they're told that they have a particular condition, I should backtrack a little and also add that gender identity and perception of gender identity also plays a role in targeting. If they feel like you don't conform to gender the way that they think you should, then it's not as important to be able to reproduce. And I think that should also be added. So SB 1135 adds in the safeguards so that when a person is diagnosed with a particular condition, they are supposed to be able to access a doctor not associated with the prison. And accessing a second opinion does not mean somebody looks at your record. It means somebody actually meets with you. And we were very explicit when we talked about this bill, when we talked with Senator Jackson, offered this, to make sure that that is how it happens. And then only then, if a person uses less invasive procedures, if a person has a verified second diagnosis, then they can go forward with a tubal ligation or not a tubal ligation, with a sterilizing procedure only for medical purposes, for medically necessary preservation of life. We don't know what other states this is happening in. We honestly don't. We haven't had a chance to even look. I know we did get a letter from someone in a men's prison talking about some odd procedure that makes them unable to ejaculate, and haven't heard back. But right now, SB 1135 is on the governor's desk. He has till the 30th to sign. If he does not sign, it goes into effect the law. But if he vetoes it, then I'll be mad. I'll be beyond mad. That's a severe understatement. But it's passed through unanimously through the legislature. So anticipating, fingers crossed, that this will be one small step. Hopefully we'll reduce the number of misdiagnoses of people that come out without a uterus, because I walked around for 10 years with jokes about how you go to the doctor and come back without a uterus. That should not be a joke. That should not be off the cuff. That is not funny. But that is what that is your everyday life, and you're not even aware or knowing or educated. So we are making a eugenics chapter through our office to educate women on the history of eugenics, to recognize the practice as it plays out in their daily lives. Beyond that, folks have questions, then we've already gone over. Please ask them.
Thank you so much. Okay, if anyone has questions, we have exactly 2 minutes. Go. I actually have a question. So Ms. Major brought up a really great point about what our role is as baby lawyers and future real lawyers. So I kind of want to put this to everyone on the panel. So we need to be a benefit to other people. That's why we're here. How do you think, as reproductive justice advocates, we can play a role in the future?
I'll go. So partly because I have to leave and say one last thing. So I think that your role as coming into the legal profession is to not forget your values as people, and to not forget that you came to law school for a reason, and if you're interested in this work, if you care about other issues, you're still a person. You're not, that being a lawyer doesn't make you some superhuman, it doesn't make you not a member of the average society, you're still here to give back. And because I'm pregnant, I get emotional. but I genuinely think that there's a place for all of us as in the vast community that is the legal profession. And you can find your place. I did litigation for 10 years, and I absolutely hated it. because I couldn't stand the tension. And I moved into the nonprofit community and still doing some legal work, and I love it. It's totally where my heart is, and I still get to do all the things that I care about. So it'll take time. There will be good times and bad times, and you'll get through it.
Beautifully said. Beautifully said.
The disease of autism, I think that we tried to paint that picture about like the intersectionality between all of these issues and why they're important and how each affects other issues and other outcomes for families. And so, I think it's really important that if you're really passionate about like reproductive rights and like protecting those rights for people, that you don't forget that like those rights should be extended to other things, and that the sort of like immigrants' rights fall in line with reproductive justice and are a part of that. If a person doesn't have the right to be with their families in this country, or to parent their children the way they want to, that's not real reproductive rights and justice. So just sort of recognizing that whatever field you go into, there's a lot of, you can't do everything, of course, but just recognizing that there are intersections between all of this work, and that I think the world would be such a better place if we could work better as allies in all of this work and do it more collaboratively, and I think that's something to think about when you go to your respective fields.
We have a question.
So my question's for Misty. My name's Sherry Bridgeworth, and I belong to SCIU Local 1000. We've had many issues with CDCR as well, and the federal receiver. Is there a coalition building that's taking place? And I ask that question specifically in regard to SCIU, since our workers are the nurses and the folks assisting these physicians in the prisons, and if there's a coalition building with SCIU, since we're in an international organization, to get the vote out, or to get the, not the vote out, but to get people to start putting pressure on the legislature and putting pressure on the governor to sign this bill.
There's definitely, I have some info sheets on SB 1135, and we have like a Twitter every day, we do like a tweet. That's definitely, SCIU can definitely do a letter of support. I can get you a template letter of support. We have, a lot of organizations from a lot of different intersections support this bill. But like coalitionally, not just like a big coalition to like stop eugenics, but like definitely a lot of support intersectionality with other organizations. And that's, I've had one meeting with the SCIU. The guy actually represents the Northern Prisons, the Mafia Care Workers, and gave me some really interesting feedback. He was a really neat guy, but I never was able to follow up. So, other than that, we can definitely exchange information and figure out other ways to support. But we definitely love a letter of support.
I think that
there are a lot of lower level workers that are oppressed by like the CMOs and the other in the prisons, and I know there's a lot of dynamics there as well. Like, and a lot of people that want to help people in the prison and get pushed out for being pro inmate. So there's definitely dynamics around that we could talk about.
Okay, and you said the information's up front.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And I add that the California Nurses Association and the California Social Worker Association were in support of the bill.
Okay, we're at time, so if you guys want to stick around and talk to any speakers, you're definitely welcome. Thank you so much.